Welcome to the next session on commodity derivatives and risk management. And in the last session, we were discussing different aspects of electricity trading. And we discussed that predominantly a major part of the electricity which is produced by a generation company is delivered to a group of companies as part of long-term power purchase agreement. Any seasonal variation in the production is also made through the short-term bilateral contract, that is a company and the generation company enter into bilateral contract. Any excess electricity which is produced by the by generation company or companies which require some, you know, for some specific reason, if they need some excess electricity for some time of the day or some time in a month, they come to the exchange platform and try to get a, arrange electricity in this exchange platform. And in the last class, we also discussed how this exchange platform solicits bid volume, bid quantity, bid price, sales quantity and sales price for every 15 minutes block for a given day, and accordingly the price matching is done to arrive at an equilibrium price which is known as market clearing price, and equilibrium volume which is known as a market clearing volume, MCP and MCV respectively. And just to take you through, I'll just show you the the Excel file which I was discussing. You remember this company different buyers and sellers give different bid volume, bid price, sell volume, sell price, that is buy volume, buy price, and sell volume, sell price, and the exchange tries to find out the equilibrium price. And we discussed also how interpolation method can be found out to arrive the equilibrium price here, and we discussed the equilibrium price is the price at which maximum volume can be cleared for that particular day, that particular time of the time slot. So we also discussed, if you recall, we also discussed with this particular this is the demand curve, this is the supply curve, this is the price, this is the quantity, and we were supposed to find out the interpolation between these four points to find out the coordinates of this intersection point. So let me repeat, we were using the xy coordinates for these four points to find out the xy value for this intersection point. And let's say for the previous example, the intersection point is at 3.20 price per kilowatt hour, and the market clearing volume is 3600 units. Now, any buyer who has quoted a price greater than 3.20, he will be allowed to buy electricity, and a seller who has quoted any price less than 3.20 will be allowed to sell electricity through the exchange platform. Of course, actual delivery will happen to the grid. The seller will be releasing, connecting its whatever generation it is doing to the grid, and buyers will also start their activities and switch on the machines or motors during that point of time. Now, I also started last class, I had also discussed about the market clearing price of maybe it is a little, let me make it a little bigger if it is visible to all of you. If you see, this is the market clearing price prevailing on 28th June 2016. So if you see, this is for the time block. What is the market clearing price? 2300.34. And if you see this is the price of megawatt hour, 1 megawatt hour. And if you see this A1, A2, E1, E, this region, so India is divided into 12 regions. So any buyer and any seller from any region is going to pay the same price. So you have 2300. If a buyer is at A1 region and a seller is let's say N1 region, everybody is paying the same price. In fact, whole of 28 January 2006, if you see, for all these 96 blocks of data, you have the same value across board. That is, all regions are paying the same MCP, and exchanges also inform what is the peak hour, what is non-peak hour, what is day, night and morning. All this detail is there here. So I will not be probably uploading this detail because you can go to Indian Energy Exchange database and download the data for 28th June to see how the price is moving, because this is a copyrighted material. I am showing it for educational purpose. However, when you will be seeing the video, I may not be making this particular worksheet available. Of course, the other worksheets I will make it available to you all, so that you can practice how MCP and MCB calculation can be done with different bid price, bid volume, and sell price and sell volume. Now this is on 28 June detail. Let's go back to a randomly selected date. I have just downloaded a date details pertaining to 18 June. Now let's see. See what I have, I have deleted some portion of the 18 June data, so that I'm making it a little smaller so that you can see. Okay, now if it is, I'm sure it is visible. If you see, the market clearing price is 2493.38 for the hour 00 to 0015, that is 12 o'clock night to 12:15 on 18 June. But if you see this price, that is your, the price prevailing at 9 to 9:15, that is 20 to 20:15. If you see, the MCP is 2019.31. However, some location A1, A2 and all, A1, 2, N3, people are, buyers and sellers are paying 2529.86, while buyers and sellers at S1 region, that is S1 and S2 region, are paying 3500.36. Let me repeat, when the market clearing price is 2619.31, in some regions buyers and sellers are paying less amount of money, while in some other region buyers and sellers are paying higher amount of money. Similarly, let's go to this one 2213 to 2245, that is 10:30 to 10:45. The market clearing price is 2650.03, while some region they have paid 2600.14, and some region, that is your N1, N2, N3, have paid 3200.27. These three regions have paid a higher amount. Now the next question comes, why the this, some region's payment is more than the MCP and some region payment receipt is less than MCP. This is to do with the congestion. If grid availability is not there, even if buyers and sellers are interested to deliver some X amount of X unit of electricity at a given point of time, but because of the congestion of the grid, this amount cannot be delivered. So if a region is considered as a surplus area, so that means there are more sellers than the buyers, then the price will be suitably reduced to arrive at something called constrained market clearing price, and a different market clearing volume will be arrived for these regions. Okay, let me repeat. Whenever there is a high demand for electricity in a given region than the total amount which could be delivered to this region because of the grid unavailability, so the price will be reduced, and vice versa, when there are more buyers than the sellers, the price will be increased. So that is the reason why you have, even if the market clearing price is X, some regions buyers and sellers are paying less than X rupees, and in some regions buyers and sellers are paying more than X rupees. So in fact these kind of rows are highlighted by Indian Energy Exchange in their website on a daily basis for every day to indicate which are the period where you have a congestion exist. So whatever buyers and sellers are wanting to buy or sell, you could not be delivered because of the grid congestion. Now, what are these bid areas? I mentioned about the bid areas. So if you can see this link, those are different bid areas. So N1 is a northern region, N2 is northern region. Of course, N1, N2, N3 is three different, whole of northern India is divided into three categories, so on so forth, E1, E2, S1, S2, A1, A2. And this is already I have discussed that MCPA and MCB which gets calculated. This again looks very textbooky because it's a very smooth curve. So it's normally does not, the curve is not so smooth as we saw it in the Excel diagram. So this aspect I have already discussed, that is what is a constrained MCP and MCB. So whenever there is a grid bottleneck, the MCP market clearing price is suitably modified, and what we get to pay or receive, or buyers or seller pay or receive, is the different MCP which are known as constrained MCP. Accordingly, the market clearing volume for those region are also adjusted. Now how exactly the whole thing happens? Day T minus 1, by 1 p.m. All buyers and seller, whoever is interested to bid, buy or sell, so bid price, bid volume, sell price, sell volume, they give it to the exchange, they send it to the exchange before 1 p.m. for any specific time, 15 minutes block. So for every 15 minutes block, a buyer can bid for all 15 minutes block or some 15 minutes block depending upon his or her interest. So the order matching order matching happens by 1 p.m. So the exchange sends the unconstrained MCP and MCB to the NLDC, that is your National Load Dispatch Center, to check whether this amount of market clearing volume can be cleared or can be transacted through the grid, whether grid has the capacity to take, because already as part of the long term power purchase agreement and bilateral agreements, different buyers and sellers are buying different generator companies and distribution companies are withdrawing and supplying electricity into the grid. So whether depending upon the grid availability, if grid is available, then this same information will be through the NLDC, RLDC and SLDC will be informed back to the exchange, and exchange will accordingly by 6 p.m. exchange will be informing to the buyers and sellers. If there is a congestion, the NLDC will inform the power exchange by 2 p.m. and power exchange will arrive at constrained MCB and area wise price based on the availability of grid capacity. So, and this calculation of MCP and MCB is known as congestion management or market splitting, and that is the reason why in the last session we discussed something about NLDC, RLDC and SLDC. So now let's quickly go into some derivative contracts which are available for power producers to hedge their risk. Of course, these contracts are not available to these futures and swaps, futures and spark spread futures contract. Any derivative contract which is traded as part of the exchange, that is not permitted in India. However, forward contracts are available to Indian generation power generation company or distribution companies, because in fact long term power purchase agreements are nothing but the forward contracts. So let's go to discussing a little bit on this forward contract. So as I mentioned, long term power purchase agreements and bilateral contracts are forward contracts. Futures contracts, of course, it is not available to be traded in Indian exchanges. They are normally cash settled. In this context, I want you to have a look at this particular contract which trades at CME, Chicago Mercantile Exchange, and you have what is the contract unit? It is for 5 MWh, and what is the settlement procedure? If you see, this is the contract shall be cash settled. So what is the maximum duration for which a buyer or seller of futures contract, this futures contract can enter into position? Current year plus next 5 years. So today being June 28th, so they can enter into contract for July, August, September, October, November, December of 2016, and contracts up to 22. So it could be monthly contract, it could be some sequence of month contract, so it strip contract, so it varies from companies to company for depending upon their actual position in the physical market. They can come to the exchange platform to mitigate the price risk. Now let's go to swaps. So if a generator is entering into a long-term power purchase agreement, it is basically agreeing to sell electricity in the forward market at a fixed price. So generators can also, generator distribution companies and end users can also enter into swap contracts. Swap contracts are bilateral OTC contracts. So what could be the position of a swap contracts? In case of a generators fear that the electricity price is going to go down, so they will be happy to receive a fixed price and pay a floating price. So many US power producers have entered into swap contracts. So as part of this contract, they receive a fixed price and pay a floating price, so they become seller of the swap. Again, distributors could be buyer of the swap or seller of the swap, depending upon what kind of a position, spot market position they have. Let's say you have a distributor which buys electricity in the spot market. It buys electricity in the spot market, but it has already or it also sells electricity in the spot market. So you know, it buys from the spot market and sells at a margin. So you know, only risk it is exposed is that margin loss. So it does not need to enter into a swap contract. Now let's go to another case of a distributor where the distributor buys electricity at a fixed price. Distributor has already entered into long-term power purchase agreement. It buys electricity at fixed price but sells electricity in the spot market. So what is the fear? If electricity price goes down, it will end up getting it will end up earning less. So what it will do, it will be selling a swap. That means it will receive electricity, it will receive a fixed price and pay a floating price. Similarly, if you can have a situation where a distributor is buys electricity in spot but it sells electricity at fixed price, in that case the distributor is going to take a buyer position. That means it will pay fixed and receive a floating rate. End user's fear is that electricity price is going to go up and they can enter into a contract to you know, pay fixed and receive the floating rate. Of course, in India specifically, many companies have their own captive power generation plants, so they are not much of a need to enter into swap agreement, because whatever their own requirement, they generate through their captive power generation units. In this context, quickly I'll take you through something called a spark spread futures contract. So with respect to soybean, we discussed crush spread. With respect to crude oil, we discussed crack spread. And with respect to this electricity, today we are discussing two different spreads. This is called your spark spread and dark spread. And futures contract on spark spread and dark spread are traded at CME. So what exactly is the spread? So spread is nothing, is the price of output minus the price of input. So in this case, price of electricity minus the price of natural gas or the price of coal. So if a company is using coal-fired plant, thermal power generation plant, so it will be calculating, or its profit will be governed, or profit will be known as the dark spread, because the price at which it will be selling electricity and the price at which it will be buying coal is going to govern the margin. Similarly, you have power generation company which is using natural gas, its spread will be known as spark spread. It will be price of electricity minus the price of natural gas. Now, if a electricity generation company is fearing that its spread is going to go down, it can enter into a short spread position on either a spark spread or a dark spread. By doing so, it will be entering into a contract to sell electricity futures. Sell electricity futures and simultaneously buys a natural gas future or coal future. So these kind of a contracts, futures contracts, are available for trading at CME and at Nord Pool. However, it is not available, as I mentioned, none of the futures or option contracts are available for electricity generators or producers and distribution companies in Indian case. And there is also another interesting dimension which I thought of discussing, because this Indian Energy Exchanges also trade the renewable energy certificates. So what are these renewable energy certificates? Whenever a power generation company is using renewable energy sources such as solar, water, etc. for generating electricity, then it starts owning the renewable energy certificate. So what exactly a 1 REC is? 1 REC represents 1 megawatt hour of energy generated from renewable sources. So if a company is generating 1 megawatt hour of electricity and using renewable sources, then it is it can own a 1 REC, that is a renewable energy certificate. So REC is now any power generation company cannot by merely producing electricity or generating electricity by using renewable energy sources, naturally will not get entitled to own this REC. There is a process of accreditation. A independent party does accreditation and does a registration, and so that a company which is using renewable energy sources can own these renewable energy certificates. And once a company owns this REC, they can take it to exchange platform for selling it to other parties which are obligated to buy these RECs. There are some companies which have to purchase RECs, specifically companies which are electricity companies which are using renewable non-renewable energy sources. They are mandated to buy RECs. So if you see this slide, who are obligated to buy RPOs or renewable purchase obligations? So if you see, as per the Government of India regulation, it is the power distribution companies, that is DISCOMs, are also required to buy RPOs, and open access consumers like big industries and companies which are buying electricity from power exchanges and companies which are buying electricity as part of the bilateral agreement, they also have to buy these RPOs. And captive consumers like those companies which are also have their own power generation units and they use coal and natural gas power plants, primarily industrial users in cement, steel, chemical sectors, etc., have to every year buy a certain number of renewable purchase obligations so that their carbon emission, they are reducing their carbon footprint. Now, let's go to, so this particular slide shows the salient features of the renewable energy certificates. Please see this one. What is the denomination of REC? REC is 1 megawatt hour. Validity is 1095 days after issuance. So the body which is interested for accreditation of renewable energy certification, that company will be issuing RECs to another power generation company which is using renewable energy sources. And this company which owns the REC can sell it to another party within this 1095 days of issuance. And these RECs can be solar RECs and non-solar RECs, and where this can be traded, they can be traded only at exchange platform. It cannot be done between OTC, it cannot be a OTC transaction between two companies entering into a contract and saying that we have exchanged the REC with each other. Banking is not allowed. That means you if you have to buy X unit, you can buy X unit only this year. You cannot buy X plus unit next previous year and say that previous year I had bought some X plus units, hence I will be, I should be permitted to buy a lesser RSA this year. So companies which have RPO, they have to buy the mandated unit every year. Borrowing, they cannot borrow, they have to buy those RPOs. And transport type is single transfer only. That means if a generation company has generated REC and has sold REC to another counterparty, that counterparty cannot sell it to another party. So the life of REC comes to an end with a single transaction, that too within 1095 days of issuance. So if the company which is owning REC has not been able to sell that REC within this mandated time, this company is not financially benefiting from the ownership of the REC. Now let's take this REC gets traded once a month at Indian Energy Exchange platform. Let's see what is the total amount of REC which has been transacted in the month of May at IEX. And if you see this particular panel, you have a solar and non-solar. And if you see exactly the same way the market clearing, different buyers and sellers give different bid volume, buy volume, sell volume, buy quantity, sell quantity, buy price, sell price, and the order matching is done exactly the way electricity MCP and MCP is cleared. So the solar during 26 May, how many buy units were demanded? So buy bids came is 17,113, and if you see how many sell bids were there, 2,800. That is 2.8 million RECs were came to the exchange platform to be sold, while 17,113 units were demanded. So obviously cleared volume will be 17,113, and what is the clear price? Clear price is 3,500 rupees per one REC. So buyers paid 3,500 rupees for every REC they bought. And how many participants were there? 482. In case of a non-solar, it is even, the number of sell bids is 7 million. And similarly, you have a cleared price is 1,500 and a number of participants. So more detail about the buy volume, say highest buy bids, lowest buy bids, sell bids, and all that. This is mentioned here. So with this, I will be winding up our discussion pertaining to electricity. As I mentioned, in India's derivative contracts on electricity do not trade in exchange. However, companies enter into long-term power purchase agreement and short-term bilateral contracts. And right now, whatever trading is happening, it is for spot delivery. And both exchanges, IEX Limited and Power Exchange Limited, also have intraday trading. That is, you can bid it. Buyers and sellers can bid today for delivering electricity on the same day at a later point of time. And we discussed about market clearing price and market clearing volume. We also discussed about constrained market clearing price and unconstrained market clearing price and volume. And we also briefly discussed about the RECs, the process of issuance of RECs, and the process of trading of RECs at Indian Energy Exchange Limited. And we also briefly discussed a little bit about the spark spread and dark spread futures contract. So if you are more interested on understanding what are the different kinds of futures contract, option contracts traded in international exchange, you can go to CME or you can go to Nord Pool. So that is commodities, Nasdaq Commodities Europe. It is now rechristened as Nasdaq Commodities Europe. So you can visit that website to understand more about different kinds of you know, derivative contracts on electricity. So with this, I am, you know, let's conclude this session, and I'll be interacting with you with respect to other commodities in the next session. So thanking all of you.